So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we discuss a set of 5 questions which are related to either current affairs or some static concepts related to finance and economics, right? So in this series, we are also going to do the same. So before we move ahead to questions, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So guys, if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button to get associated with us, and do not forget to press this bell icon so that you can get all the notifications regarding all the videos that come up, right? You can also join our Telegram group, and on this group you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to take them up as soon as possible. So since we are talking about queries, you can always post your doubts as comments on the videos and we'll try to resolve them, right? Okay, are you ready for question number one? So here is question number one. Okay, I hope the screen is perfectly visible. This question says, currently if a company's market cap is above 10,000 crores and it needs to sell at least 10% in its IPO, then it needs to sell at least 10% in its IPO. But this rule creates problems for a particular set of issuers. Which issuers are being talked about here? Right. So this rule creates problems for some issuers that are trying to raise money through the mode of IPO. You have to tell which out of these 5 is the correct option. Moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option C. Option C means large sized firms, right? So guys, this question comes from a latest news in which SEBI has put up some proposals, some recommendations that we should try to make the rules a little less stricter regarding IPO so that it becomes easier to raise money, right? Okay, now talking about this, see, this rule says that if it is a large size issuer, if there is a company which is of very large size and its market cap is above 10,000 crore, then when it comes out for IPO, it tries to raise money from the public, it has to sell at least 10% of its share through that IPO, right? But it sometimes creates problem for large size issuers. And sorry, why is this so? Because 10% in case of large sized issuers, it might mean a lot number of shares, right? So when they flush the market with so many shares, then it might lead to dilution of control for these large sized companies, right? So this is one factor, and apart from that, it might be very difficult for these companies to handle all the formalities, all the complexities of issuing this much amount of shares in the market, right? So it has been proposed to reduce. Okay, so consultation paper by SEBI, which proposes to reduce this percentage to 5%, which is currently 10%, so that it becomes easier for large size issuers. They can have the IPO with releasing lesser amount of shares, right? It might help an upcoming IPO of the country's largest insurer, that is LIC, since the value of the shares on offer in the IPO may be too high for the investors to absorb. So if they keep 10%, so it might lead to a lot of shares flushing the market, right? So when the supply of shares is also very large, it might impact the share price. It might break down the share price, which the company, the issuer, might not want to. So there can be many problems, especially for large size issuers. So guys, the simple logic here is a large size issuers. So in case of a large sized company, the 10% percentage, it becomes lot of number of shares, right? Might not become that many shares for a smaller company. So it may also take much longer for LIC to comply with 25% minimum float norm, since Even a 5% sale would be larger than most of the share sales to the public because LIC is such a large size issuer. So this proposal's main aim is to support the upcoming IPO of LIC, right? So SEBI said large issuers already have investment by private equity or strategic investors who are classified as public shareholders. So post listing, mandating minimum 10% of the market cap leads to unnecessary dilution of holdings. As I told you, unnecessary dilution of holdings of existing shares. So this is one constraining factor which might come in the way of large issuers raising the money, right? So SEBI has proposed to. So now what SEBI has proposed it? That proposed, this is one recommendation from the consultation paper, that if there is a company where market cap exceeds 10,000 crore, we can do one thing, we can divide it into two parts. So till 10,000 crore, let's say there is a company whose market cap is 15,000 crores, right? So for 10,000, it has to issue shares worth 1,000 crore, right? So you are breaking this 15,000 into two parts. You are breaking the market cap into two parts, 10,000 crores and whatever exceeds. In this case, 5,000. So on this 10,000, the 10% cap applies, which means at least 1,000 crore shares worth of shares have to be issued. And for this 5,000, they can issue 5% of the market cap exceeding. So on this 5,000, they rather than going for 10%, they can go for 5%, which means issuing shares worth 250 crores, right? So this is what has been recommended to support the upcoming IPO of LIC. And you know, the size of LIC is huge, right? Moving ahead to the next question for today. Okay, this is the next question, which says, Lalit was in his finance class. His teacher told him about a new class of bank NBFCs approved by RBI to manage content for financial data sharing, right? So a new class of companies for financial data sharing. Okay, let's read ahead. These entities automatically collect information from accounts at different institutions, bring it to one place and makes the information available to other system. But just as the teacher was about to tell the name of the same, his friend Munna involved him in some other discussion and Lalit was unable to hear the name. Now, could you help him? You have to tell what is the name of these this class of NBFCs which is being about which his teacher is telling him, right? Moving ahead to the solution. And the correct option for this question is option D, which means account aggregators, right? So this is a very common term. Recently there are many articles which are written about it. So I think the name in itself tells you, account aggregators. So a company which has the duty or which has the job of aggregating the accounts. So in simple terms, it is just a company or an NBFC which is going to collect information about different accounts, about different people having accounts, about different companies having account, and put that information at one place, right? Here you can see in this case study that entities collect financial information from different institutions, bring it to one place, compile it, and they try to analyze it, and they try to analyze the credit worthiness of different entities. So whenever these entities, they come out to borrow, they have a chart prepared for them, or they have an analysis of their credit worthiness, right? See, why is this account aggregation platform very important? Because one major problem that the small sized companies or the small sized entities in our country face is that they are unable to raise loans by banks because banks want an analysis of your credit worthiness. But no information about such small entities is available to the bank or to the lending institutions. That is why it is difficult for them to raise money. And the cost of borrowing becomes high even if someone is, or if, even if an entity is willing to lend to them. So if we have a platform where all the information about different entities is available, then these lending institutions would have a database, and they can easily check that which borrower is credit worthy. And even if there is a small company which has a good credit worthy record, a healthy financial record, then that small company might get loans, might get access to credit at a lower cost of borrowing, right? So this is the main importance of this account aggregator platforms. Apart from that, there can be many uses of it. For different stakeholders, government can also use it for tracking down the performance of different companies, right? So for banks also, apart from analyzing the credit worthiness, they can also look for the financial performance of different companies, whether they are about to lend to them, or whether they are going to open accounts for them, or any services they are going to provide to them, right? So basically creating an information database. Let's learn some more things about account aggregation. Works by compiling information from different accounts, may include bank accounts, credit card accounts, investment accounts, and other consumer business accounts, right? So these models eliminate the need to collect paper statements and manually key data into financial planning, performance reporting, CRM. So as I told you, different uses, right? CRM, client portals, or other systems. So here we can also analyze one more benefit, that since it is reducing the time that goes into formalities, that goes into documentation, that goes into collection of information, that time is going to reduce. And obviously with time, there is some associated cost. So if this effort reduces, the cost also comes down. So the cost of processes, it comes down, right? Involves collection, assembly, synthesis. I think you can read it on your own. Nothing very difficult here. So in July 2019, Nandan Nilekani, I think he needs no introduction. Nandan Nilekani introduced an account aggregator platform, digital public infrastructure developed in collaboration with major Indian financial regulators to manage data on behalf of consumers and streamline its access to payments. I think it's a very simple statement that Nandan Nilekani came up with a platform which had compiled information about different entities, financial information about different entities, right? So data is critical, and individuals or business can get their transactions in the account aggregator ecosystem. So if someone wants that their details should be uploaded in such a platform, they can also go for it. So then in future, whenever they will need credit or they will need some other financial services, their data is somewhere available, right? So Nilekani also called for cooperation between the two countries to generate ideas in account aggregation. So guys, here is one question for you. Recently, Nandan Nilekani talked about a country, and he said that this country is very good with biometrics and smart card stuff. So let's cooperate with them and learn some new things which we can use in our own country. Now you have to tell which country is this Nilekani was talking about, right? So I hope to see your answers in the comments. So this is about account aggregator platforms, right? So see, apart from businesses, there can be a good use of account aggregator platforms in different sectors like SMEs or agriculture sectors. So basically these are the sectors where India needs to improve a lot, because we have a huge chunk of population involved in these sectors, but these are not as developed as we want them to be, right? So if we want to develop such small sectors, or our manufacturing units, or industries like textiles, or the farming activities, we can make the use of such technologies like an account aggregator platform, right? Moving ahead to the next question. Okay, here is the third question for today. I hope you can view the screen properly. So this question says, following are some statements about participatory notes. Select the ones which are not correct in this regard. Very simple question. Three statements given to you regarding participatory notes. So there have been many doubts, many queries regarding participatory notes. I hope you get your doubts cleared here, right? So you have to tell the statements which are not correct. Moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option C. Option C means 1 and 2 are not correct, which means 3 is correct. 1 and 2 not correct. So before coming to statements, let's look at the concept and then we'll come back to the statements. Now, what is participatory notes, also called P notes or PNs? See, these are very simple instruments. Basically, these are financial instruments that allow foreign investors to invest into Indian shares, shares by Indian company or securities of Indian companies without getting themselves registered with SEBI, right? See, foreign investment can be a boon or can be a curse for the country depending upon situations. Why boon? Because it comes up with a lot of capital, it fulfills the need of a country, financial need of a country, and especially a growing developing economy like India, which is in need of capital. These foreign investors can do the job. But if they are allowed to roam freely without any regulation, then they might create some volatility or instability in the financial sector of the country. And obviously, regulators do not want that. And if we consider our regulators, be it RBI, be it SEBI, they are not considered very, they are considered very conservative in their approach. Although they have been now opening up or warming up to some new trends, right? So, that is why regulators try to keep a track of the foreign investors who want to invest in the country, especially huge investors or institutional investors. But if there are some investors that want to invest into India and do not want to get into the formalities of getting themselves registered with the regulator, the instrument that they can use is P notes or participatory notes, right? Allows investors or hedge funds to invest in Indian securities without having to register with SEBI. Derivative instruments underlying Indian assets. So see, they basically their value, the value of a P note will depend upon the share, which is the underlying share for that particular instrument. So it's not that some Indian companies issue P notes, but the value of P notes depend upon the shares, which are the underlying or basis shares for that particular P note, right? So just as there are derivatives which are based, what are derivatives? I hope you remember we have studied derivatives in detail in one of our initial sessions. So just as there are derivatives based who derive their value from the value of another asset, another instrument, similarly there are P notes deriving their value from Indian assets. So they are derivative instruments. So what is the benefit here of P notes? Investors, they save time. Obviously, they do not have to get into the formalities of registration. They save money because with registration there come some fees or the cost, which is some documentation cost, which is associated, and scrutiny. So this is one major point. They escape the scrutiny which is associated with direct registration. That is why Indian regulators not very fond of or not very supportive of participatory notes, because they fear that it can create volatility in the economy, right? So let's go back to the statements. Okay, the first statement says participatory notes allow registered investors to invest in the Indian market. This is not right because it allows unregistered investors, right? So that is the correct statement. Statement 2 says they are a medium through which foreign investors can invest in Indian treasury bills, not in Indian treasury bills, but a range of financial assets. Indian financial, let's not cut Indian here. Okay. Financial assets, right? So these are the correct statements. And statement 3, popular because of their anonymity, the feature of anonymity that they provide to the foreign investors, right? So these are the correct statements. I hope now you are clear with participatory notes. Moving ahead to question number 4. Okay, here is question number 4th for today, which says a government department wants to know about the data regarding hoarding of money in the country. Which of the following ratios can be used by that department? Right, simple question, 5 options. And moving ahead to the correct option, and the correct option for this question is option A, that is cash to GDP ratio. So very simple, guys, we are trying to find that what is the amount of cash that is going on in the economy or that is circulating through the economy, and we relate it to the GDP. Basically, we are finding a ratio, we are dividing cash by GDP so that we can find a ratio. See, why are we trying to relate it to GDP? Because this is very obvious. When a country grows, when an economy grows, GDP is bound to increase. So GDP goes up, right? And cash also goes up, because obviously if GDP is rising, that means people have more money and they are going to spend it. That means cash circulation also goes up, right? So now, if both of them are going up and the proportion is almost same, then the ratio is not going to change much. But if, what if the GDP is not rising much, or the GDP is not rising, GDP is stagnant, but still the ratio, the entire ratio is rising, then we can analyze from it that cash is rising. That is why the increase in the numerator is going to make the ratio go upward, right? So that means GDP is stagnant, economy is not growing, but cash is growing. That means people are using cash rather than going for digital payments. So they are trying to look for cash, or they are dealing in cash, right? So this ratio gives us an idea that what is the tendency currently which is prevalent in the citizens of a country, whether they want to hoard cash, whether they want to convert it in some sort of assets, right? So let's learn some more things about this ratio. Okay. Ever since COVID stuck, Indians have been stashing cash. I think this is very obvious. In any times of uncertainty, people have a tendency to hoard cash or to look for cash or to store as much as cash they can or as much as is possible, because they think, what if we are not able to earn this much money in the future? Or what if we put our money into some assets that cannot be liquidated easily in future, that cannot be converted into cash in future? That is why they try to keep some hard cash with them. So with COVID-19, there was uncertainty leading to hoarding of cash or stashing of cash, driven by basic tendency to save into most liquid asset during a crisis, right? Here you can see some data. Cash withdrawals from bank branches and ATMs have increased sharply because people are trying to take their money out of banks and keep it safe in their houses. Although inflation is going to act on that money which is hoarded, but still people think that it is safe to do it. Currency in circulation has grown at a rate of 21%, a decadal high, and shows no signs of reducing or abating, right? So cash to GDP ratio, an accurate measure of hoarding. Ratio came back to the historic trend of 12% after the drop due to demonetization. When there was demonetization, cash was sucked out of from the economy, and cash to GDP ratio fell. But it came back, it gained an upward trend once again. But the recent growth has been really high. The recent growth that this ratio could surge to 14-15% of GDP, right? So, and we know that our GDP currently is in a bad state, not in a very good state. So if GDP is not rising, but the cash is rising, cash, that means people are trying to deal in cash rather than going for some other modes. So part of this would be simply because GDP would shrink this year due to recession, right? Lot of it comes because cash is rising despite RBI and the government pushing for digital payment methods. So much of the growth this year in output would be from rural economy. So this is also one major factor talking about the rural economy. Guys, if you remember, we have talked about when the reverse migration began during this COVID period, right? And there was some seasonal employment. So rural economy performed better than what it was expected to do, right? So since whatever growth there is now in the Indian economy is majorly driven by rural economy, and the rural economy is majorly based on cash, right? So this rise in cash can also be attributed to this linkage. So cash to GDP ratio. Moving ahead to the last question. Here is the last question for today. Okay, this question says, Babu Rao Ganpat Rao Apte is a 60-year-old man. He is thinking to apply for some shares in the initial public offering for a company which is called Lakshmi Fund. And Babu Rao has been impressed by a new scheme launched by a company which is called Ekka Double. And his tenant Raju advises him that he can. Babu Rao Apte can apply for these shares using an application system which will not deduct the amount from his account but only block the funds which are needed to apply for shares in the IPO. So could you tell the name that Babu Rao Ganpat Rao Apte can use, right? So here are your options. You have to tell the name of this particular application or this particular system, this approach. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question. And the correct option for this question is application supported by blocked amount ASBA. So this has been asked by one of you in the comments. I hope you get to clarify whatever your doubt was. Now talking about ASBA, that is application supported by blocked amount. So it's very simple, guys. Whenever there is an IPO and you want to apply for some shares, you apply for those shares and you have to pay the fees which is associated with it. You have to, since you want to buy those shares, you have to pay some amount of the worth of the shares that you want to buy, right? So that goes with your application. But what happens is sometimes when an investor, let's say I am going to apply for some shares during an IPO, but I'm not allotted any shares. So my money is stuck and it's going to be refunded later. So sometimes this becomes a hectic process and funds can be stuck in between, and the investor who has not been allotted shares can be into a troublesome situation. So to mitigate this, this system can help ASBA. In this, what happens is, money is blocked in from your account, but the deduction is made only when shares are allotted to you. So if you're not being allotted any shares by the company, then no money is going to be deducted. So there is no process of refund, right? So to cut the processes short, to make them more efficient or to make them more investor friendly, this system can help. Okay, here you can see application containing an authorization to block the application money into bank account. That means your bank account must have this much of balance that you need to pay to the company in case you are allotted the shares. So funds are blocked. So it might happen that company might issue shares to you, but your account does not have sufficient funds to pay them. So that is why funds are blocked. But the deduction is made, account is debited only if the application is selected for allotment after the basis of allotment is finalized and or the issue is withdrawn or failed, right? So supplementary process of applying in IPO and FPOs made through book building routes and coexist with the current process of using check as a mode of payment and submitting the applications. So it has not replaced the traditional methods, but it is running parallel to them. But obviously this is simpler, this is cost effective, and this is more investor friendly, right? Investor deals with the known intermediary, his or her own bank, because bank is going to block the funds, right? So this is ASBA. I think was a simple concept. Okay. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope these questions added something new to your knowledge, and if they did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Until then, you take care of yourselves, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here.